This is the GBox from Chuwi. It's their new Windows 10 home mini PC. It's powered by the Intel Celeron N4100. That is the Gemini Lake, the successor to the Apollo Lake. So it's slightly faster. The clock speeds are up 200 megahertz and now has HDMI 2.0 support, double data rate 4. This model's got 4 gigabytes of RAM, which is not a lot, but it'd still be enough for most mini PC tasks. I hope to see an 8 gigabyte model, however. It has 64 gigabytes of internal storage, which is eMMC 5.1 spec, which is reasonably fast. Now, if you want more capacity and faster storage, then you can upgrade it. There's two ways you can do that. So you can either install a 2.5-inch hard drive or SSD, or an M.2 SATA 3 SSD into this model. I'll show you how to do this in the video, and we'll also cover the performance and then my overall opinions of Chuwi's new Windows 10 budget mini PC. Inside the typical Chuwi box, we've got the mini PC there, which, getting it out, it does actually feel a little bit heavy because the frame around the outside is all made out of metal, but I will show you that in a minute. We have a little leaflet in here, so that's just your warranty card and all of that, instruction manual, specs. Then stuffed inside the box on the side, you'll find the power adapters. This is 12 volts, 2 amps, DC in. Then we have the little air remote. So this is very similar to one of the first mini PCs that I reviewed from Chuwi. And the power cable, so this will either be a UK1, EU or US, depending on what model you're buying. And then there are some screws and the adapter, so you can mount this on the back of your TV using a VESA mount. So the little remote here is very similar to those LG Magic remotes, if you ever use those for LG TVs. So when you move it around, the mouse pointer then moves around on the screen. So it's quite easy to control and use and good for media centers and things like that. You've got your basic controls here, LED, power on, the menu, back mouse click button, as you can see, which is this one. So left mouse button, home, and then volume up and down. Looking at the design of the GBox, so we've got this metal that goes all around the outside and it does feel very solid thanks to that metal. The top of it, this is made out of plastic and it does have this vent that goes all the way around. So underneath this, there's a heatsink. There is no fan in this mini PC, so it's passively cooled, zero noise, which is really good. Along the bottom, we've got this rubber foot that goes around the whole outside. This is the panel you need to remove to gain access to the 2.5-inch hard drive, which I will show you in just a minute. On the front of the device, you have the power button, status LED, micro SD card slot that is only wired up via USB 2 hub. So speeds are going to cap out on your micro SD cards at about 23 megabytes per second, which is a shame. But we do have, of course, USB 3 ports on there. So two on the front and a USB 3 Type-C port. Then along the back, reset button, DC in, VGA, HDMI 2.0A, gigabit LAN, two USB 2 ports, and audio out. Now VGA on here, I don't know where a lot of people will probably be using that in 2018. Personally, I would have rather had another HDMI 2.0 out, just like the AlphaWise T1. To the left and right of the device, there are no additional ports, it's just bare metal. So we have two upgrade options. One's advertised, and that is to install a SATA 3 SSD 2.5 inches. There is the bay there. So you need to remove all of the screws just on this rear panel. That is relatively easy. And then if you want to install a M.2 SATA 3 SSD 2242, then it's a little bit more complicated. You have to remove all these screws around the outside, lift this out here, and then the motherboard, well, I've already partially removed that, you have to remove about three more screws, actually four more screws. It is somewhat tricky to get out because there are these cables here, there's a plug on the rear as well, so Chuwi probably doesn't want us going this far, and that's probably why they don't advertise the fact that it does have this important SSD slot here. Now you can see the heatsink is made out of an alloy, it's very large, it doesn't have the fins like the advertising material, but it is very large and quite thick in size, so it should do the job. What we're looking at now is the wireless AC chipset, so it's an Intel 3165. The two wireless antennas are located in the lid of the device where the plastic is for the best reception, of course. So for SSD sizes, we have two options, 2242, which I'm going to install right here, or a 2280. Now, it doesn't actually come with a screw, unfortunately, so that's another sign that Chuwi doesn't really want us to go this far into the internals. So because there are a few fiddly cables in there, it's very easy to damage perhaps the wireless antennas as well. I recommend probably your best bet is just to do this. So slot in either a solid state drive or a 2.5-inch spindle hard drive,
up to 2 terabytes. So jumping right into the BIOS here first, you can see that the memory speed there, 2133 megahertz. Now, that's not the fastest that this chipset supports, which is in fact 2.4 gigahertz as seen in the EasyBook X4. Now, we've got options here for secure boot, obviously boot order. We need to change that if you decide to upgrade the hard drive or put an SSD in there. And that's it. So no advanced settings like power limits with this mini PC. So this is the screen you get on first boot. I'll set up languages. We've got English, German, Spanish, French, Italian, Korean, and Russian. And Chinese, of course. This boot, you get approximately 43 gigabytes free on the 64 gigabytes of eMMC 5.1 storage that this has on here. So it's not a lot of free space. Of course, you'd probably put in a larger extra drive. You can see I've got my 2 drives in there. They're detected fine. They're running at their full SATA 3 speeds. So no problems with that. I've tested out the USB ports on there. They power external hard drives up to my large 4 terabyte drive without any problems. It didn't cut out. So that is good there. So the drives of that SanDisk, it's actually a SanDisk they've gone with, and these are good for eMMC 5.1, no complaints here with the speeds. It's not the fastest I have seen, but it will not bottleneck the system really. It's gonna be perfectly fine there. The bottleneck will be, of course, the CPU. So when you have a look in the device manager, you've got the 4 cores of the CPU there, and there's nothing really of interest here to point out, only that the Intel Wireless AC31 that I already showed you. So I found the range to be good, and you're gonna get about 320 megabits per second, the maximum throughput from this. So it's not super quick. You can get faster probably from an external one there. So we do have the 2 microphones inside, and I have recorded a quick sample here for you.
As you can hear now from this sample, the microphone quality is not amazing as you'd expect for microphones located within the GBox here. Now, it's enough for Windows Cortana. It's working fine with it.
Windows did fully activate, so there's no problems with the license, and we have only 3.84 gigabytes free to us, which is, of course, not a lot. I really want to see an 8 gigabyte model and more. Hopefully 8 gigabyte models with the Gemini Lake of Tech coming out from China. I know TechLass, they're working on something with 8 gigabytes. And you also see that the RAM speeds, when I did take a look at them, and the BIOS, they're exactly the same here. So they're saying it is running in dual channel, according to this, but DIMM slots, no. So there's no SODIMM slots on this. You cannot upgrade the RAM. Now a synthetic benchmark, well, this is Geekbench 4, and it does show that the single core scores here are up approximately 23%, 24% over the Apollo Lake M3450, that other Celeron chip, last year's one. And then the multi-core score is also up about approximately 19%. So I would not get the Celeron M34 mini PCs anymore. Stick now to the Gemini Lake, get the latest ones, because it's definitely worth it for the performance you're gaining. I know we're losing 2 gigabytes of RAM, but it is faster RAM, and we also have things like HDMI 2.0a. And the Antutu score. Now this is a dated version of Antutu that's on the Windows Store, but this puts it 140,000, about the same as the Snapdragon 660. If this happened to be running Android, of course, it's not dual boot anymore. Intel don't support dual boots on these since the old Cherry Trails, which is a shame. I'm going to boot over to Linux Mint. So what I did is just go into the BIOS, and then from the BIOS on the save and exit menu, you've got a boot override menu, and you can just select to boot to your USB pen drive. So let's see how it runs. So it is running Linux Mint perfectly fine. This is just one of the latest builds that I have loaded from that pen drive. Internet is working. As far as I can tell, everything works there. The performance also seems decent. And even the little remote is working as well in Linux. I just push the back button then, and I'll just enable the mouse too. You'll see the mouse cursor is going around. So that works too in Linux, which is great. Moving over to real world performance, and this is what matters to me, and I'm pretty sure everyone else. So you can do minor Photoshop edits. Now, if you've got a huge amount of layers, filters, and things like that, expect some slowdown. Remember that this only does have 4 gigabytes of RAM, so you are really pushing it. This is not a Core i5, this is not a Core i7. This is a very low powered 6 watt CPU in there. So I'm running quite a few things at the moment. I also have 4K streaming, you can see here in the background. I'm just pushing it to the absolute limit. So that CPU now you can see is running at 100%. So it's really taxed. Now, normally you would not do this. With these kind of systems, you need to close things down. You can't keep things open like you've got 32 gigabytes or 16 gigabytes of RAM. No, you've only got the 4 there. So remember that. Steam is also there in the background. I think I'm downloading something that's probably actually finished now. So even swapping between these, I've got a spreadsheet here. You can see the performance is fine. Now, spreadsheet editing, things like this, is the perfect kind of use for one of these mini PCs. So light tasks, editing documents, checking your emails, writing emails, basic internet browsing is all perfect for this type of chipset. And there's the Word document there as well. So you can scrolling up there, a little bit off lag. But again, bear in mind that I've got a lot of things open here at the moment. I just want to show you how far you can push these little mini PCs, how far you can push the Sauron N4100. Now in Kodi, I'm using the little magic remote, so it will work if you tap the mouse button, then you've got the mouse pointer. It takes a little while to get used to. As I mentioned, it's kind of like those LG magic remotes. So the menu key is our right mouse button, and the OK is the left mouse button, and the power button just puts it into sleep or turns it on. So I'm going to play now that same exact file. No, I won't actually. I'm going to play a 4K file here recorded on the Samsung Galaxy Note 4 and see how it plays that. And you can see that a little bit of stutters at the beginning, but it's relatively smooth and running around 50 frames per second there. And using the remote again, I'm just going to skip ahead. So that's working fine. Kodi performance I've found is actually better than the Windows video player. Now I've moved over into Edge. I'm streaming one of my videos in 4K. And you can see zero dropped frames. So Edge does a much better job at this than Chrome does. So I'll just get out of this, we'll close it down. And I will now play a HEVC codec, which is 140 megabits per second, 10 bit. This is a very demanding file, 4K, remember. And you'll see at the start that it will stutter a little bit. This is the same exact kind of performance as the Apollo Lake. So this is native VP9 and HEVC decoding, and you can see once it gets going, that runs perfectly fine. That is now very smooth. That's running at 30 frames per second. And just to also show you that without having all those things going on in the background, once you close down those applications, you manage the memory a little bit here, you can see now that this spreadsheet is very smooth. The same goes for any Word document, so the system's perfectly fine for that. And on to gaming performance. So light engine titles, for example, League of Legends, which I'm playing right now. This is running in 1080p on the medium settings, hovering around 36 frames per second, so you can see. So the performance is not wonderful, but the game at least is playable. Now, if you lower the settings, you'll boost up that frame rate by about 10 frames per second. Android emulation, so BlueStacks, that is an Android emulator, and it will run very slow. You need a much more powerful system for this. I've got PUBG here loaded because someone asked me to test it out and asked me if it would run it. Well, you can see it runs the game, but at about 10 to 5 frames per second, dipping down to even 3 frames per second, impossible to play it. This is Counter-Strike Global Offensive on 720p resolution, lower settings, and super choppy, down to 11 frames per second, hovering around 20, and it just is not playable at all. Now I tried to boost the performance. I ran a program called Read Write Everything, and I entered in the memory hack that we do to override and get rid of the power limit, but it didn't take. It doesn't work, so I can't double the frame rate like I did with the EasyBook X4. I was able to double my frame rate with that one, which worked really well, but I just cannot do it with this, so I wouldn't buy this mini PC for gaming performance. So looking now at the thermals and the wattage. So it's gonna pull about 12 watts maximum from the wall, 1213, which is ideal, it's fine. This is a mini PC, a low powered PC, so it doesn't consume a lot of power at all. Thermals cap out at 85, 86 degrees. They plateau at that temperature, they will not exceed it. So this is fine, remember that it is passively cooled, it's not actively cooled, there's no fan in there. So this really is a very decent little mini PC here from Chuwi. We've got a good build quality, the metal frame around the outside makes it feel quite sturdy. Now I didn't mention in the beginning, but the USB ports are actually upside down, that's very minor, so you just have to remember to flip things around. Plastic on the top. It does get warm after hours of use, but it's nothing alarming. There's no fans in here, so you don't have to worry about, number one, fan noise. Number two, it falling full of dust, eventually clogging up those fans and causing it to overheat. So thermals top out at 86 degrees. It's not going to go over that, at least here with my ambient temperature of 26 degrees. That's good. I really do like the little remote. So this remote, I remember testing it out with the high box, and it's good because it means you don't actually need a Bluetooth mouse or a mouse connected if you want to launch something basic, like you want to launch some video files from a hard drive, then it is all possible from a distance using that little remote there. So it works well, it does the job, and it's good to have it included in the box. So the performance, yes, it's faster than the Polaroid N3450s, typical chipsets that you would see from last year, and those models I wouldn't go for anymore. So you've got HDMI 2.0 on this now, and we have about 20%, according to synthetic benchmarks, more performance. So it does feel a little bit snappier. Definitely go with an SSD if you can, if you want to boost the performance. It just makes it load apps up faster and just feels quicker overall. So it does come recommended from me. There's just a couple of things that I wish it had. So first off, I wish there was an option in the BIOS that if you powered it on, you plugged in the power, that is, that it would automatically turn on if you wanted to, that you could set that. It's only the Intel Nukes that seem to do that. The other is, of course, you probably already know and you're aware of, the RAM, 4 GB of RAM in 2018. It's just not enough. I want to see these Gemini Lakes with 8 GB or at least 6 GB. Now, apparently 6 GB systems are coming soon, but an 8 GB version would be the sweet spot with this, I feel. And that gaming performance isn't particularly wonderful with the 6 watt TDP. Thanks a lot for watching this review. I hope you did like it. It's long, but I did include a lot of details, like all my other videos. And I hope to see you back soon in the channel. Bye for now.